Ladies and gentlemen, all staff, welcome to Convocation, your kickoff to the 2020-2021 school year. Please welcome your superintendent, Dr. Andrea Celico.
Welcome. It is really hard to say welcome back while staring into the lens of a camera. But this is our new reality, and unfortunately, will be for even longer. Normally, I would be welcoming you back and talking about how fast summer went. But frankly, if it wasn't for the suntan, I'm not sure I would even thought it was summer. Days start to blend together, and it seems like the work never ends. But there will be normalcy again, and there will be a day when we can come together and replace our elbow bumps with hugs. We will just have to continue to be patient as we wait until that day arrives. In the meantime, we can't let a virus stop us from fulfilling our goals and carrying on with a kickoff to another year. Today, like every other day, despite how the message is delivered, is intended to be fun yet focused. Before we get started with our usual twists in messaging, I want to thank everyone who helped create this video, whether you participated in an event or helped create this video, it is much appreciated. Dan Humphrey has been a great addition to our team as he puts together many great productions, and today's is no exception. As customary, our Board of Education members are usually in attendance, and I can assure you they are here in spirit and will be provided with a copy of Convocation for their viewing pleasure. Mr. Stevens, Board President, will deliver a speech to you in a few short moments. But before we introduce him, welcome to Convocation 2020 Virtual Style.
And now, taking the field, your board president, Phil Stevens.
Good morning, staff. I hope all is well with you and your family. We are facing challenging times in education now. It was just 3 or 4 years ago that I stood in front of you at Convocation talking about being innovative and creative with our learning styles and methods of teaching. Comparing the traditional style of teaching and learning in the 60s and 70s, or even the modern ways of teaching, how technology has changed throughout our educational experiences. We talked about how math, science, English, and social studies used to be back in the day in the 60s, 70s, but then we talked about how that turned over to content mastery, critical thinking, communication, collaboration, and creativity. So as you can see how things have changed, and now look at us at this stage now, making PPE a part of our daily lives, and now teaching online, and just the things that we have to do now to teach our students. We have made a lot of tough decisions and more to come through these challenging times of the unknown. I know there's a lot of fear in the unknown, but we must starve our fears and feed our faith in what we believe in and stay focused on our purpose. Our students need you. Our professional and personal lives have changed tremendously. We must find ways to adapt. The key to the different adversities that we may face in life is how we handle them when it happens to you. It's like life is almost like a baseball batter and a pitcher. If you think about that concept, picture yourself as a batter. And a pitcher is throwing that ball at you. He may throw a curve, he may throw a slider, he may throw even a fastball. But what are you going to do when that fastball comes your way? Are you going to adjust? Are you going to get back in the batter's box and wait for that fastball? Are you going to come up and choke up with that bat and meet that curveball as it comes your way? Those are some of the adjustments that we have to do and change within our own lifestyle now and our own teaching habits. So those of you who understand my concept of what I was saying, Those are the different things that we need to face when we face adversities. Those are the different things that we need to change. Then you can hit that home run, get on that first base, do whatever you need to do to meet those challenges. The rules is in your hands. The games is in your hands. We can do it together if we work together. With all that being said, once again, tough decisions are going to have to be made. We care about you. I want you to take care of yourself. We care and we want you to stay healthy. This is a new experience for us and we need to work together. Thank you and have a great year.
Heading in to return the kick is the Assistant Superintendent, Dr. Cassandra Johnson.
As the Assistant Superintendent of the Bedford City School District, I would like to take this opportunity to welcome everyone back to the 2021 school year. With that being said, I had the opportunity of welcoming the new certificated employees to the Bedford City School District. I would like to start out with Bedford High School. We welcome Caitlin Holbury, Shaylee Stearns, Willie Colbert, Sean Harold, Caitlin Kuntz, and Kyle Murrow. Carrollwood Intermediate School, we welcome Leah French. Central Office Team, we welcome Dorinda Hall and Claire Gowing. I would also like to take this time to welcome our two mental health therapists, Taisha Cromedy and Lisa Marks. At Central Primary, we welcome Kimberly Brumigan. At Glendale Primary, we welcome Katie Pym, Cameron Terrell, and Natalie Colcar. Columbus Intermediate School, we welcome new principal, Tina Threet. And at Heskett Middle School, we would like to welcome Kaylin Durham. Again, thank you for choosing Bedford City School District, and we welcome you.
And that brings us to the end of the first quarter. It's time for the ball toss. And now to attempt the extra point, welcome back Dr. Andrea Celico.
I want to talk about the why we are here, and what better way to do that than to start with our mission statement. We created this over a year ago. By now, everyone should be able to recite it. The word inspire is instrumental to helping students learn. If they're not motivated, learning suffers. The word everyone is critical because we are here to serve all students and to meet the individual needs of every student who passes through our doors, or in this new reality, comes on our screen. What is our end result? It is that all students not only graduate, but they become well-rounded, contributing members of society. With that in mind, our committee created the vision statement that all students will graduate as open-minded, responsible citizens. The words open-minded take on a whole new meaning, especially in light of what is happening around us. It is our job as educators to help our students be accepting of all races, backgrounds, identities, genders, and differences. In order for us to attain our goals and dreams for our students, we must have guiding values that help support our vision and mission. You can see them listed here, and you can see how each one ties into our vision and mission. We preserve the respect as a right and responsibility to honor the work that has been done in years past and what students and staff have grown to value. Respect is not just given, it is earned. And it is us who must earn it rather than expect it. Let's do our part to show mutual respect to everyone that we encounter. The Board of Education graciously accepted the recommendation to begin the year after Labor Day. That afforded us several more days to prepare for the hardships and challenges that lie ahead. We need to stay focused on various topics over the next several days. You have received the schedule of events and can see that we will be looking to accomplish a number of things. First and foremost, we need you to be prepared, and we are doing everything we can to help you. There will be sessions on various technological topics ranging from navigating various tools to expressing your creativity for online learning. We also believe it is important for you to spend time planning with your colleagues. Therefore, we are giving you days to accomplish that. And finally, we will be focusing on equity for our students through the learning about the importance of co-teaching as we strive to co-plan, to co-teach, to co-serve our students. In doing so, we will also address the social justice issues that surround us and the impact it has on our students. While doing so, we will challenge you to confront your biases to help you become a better teacher and to open your mind and expand your understanding of those that are different than you. Please come with an open mind, an open heart that will not be judged or pressured, but rather accepted. All right, here is a small break from the heavy stuff. What's going on this year? First, and most obviously, we will all be adapting to online learning. Why adapting? We've been knee-deep in the virtual world for months. The answer, we will be doing things differently this time around. We've gathered much feedback from our staff, students, and parents that we believe will aid us in becoming more effective. With that said, we have done a phenomenal job of educating our students and caring for their needs through this pandemic. Now, we will be even more fabulous as we adhere to some expectations. First and foremost, we must be in front of our students. We will not rely on a platform, videos, or programs to replace the most effective way students learn, through teacher instruction. It will be our job to think out of the box in creating various learning opportunities and SEL supports for our students and families. Many of you have expressed that you've worked harder, and I believe our jobs are not going to get easier, personally or professionally. This is an extremely challenging time on both fronts for so many of us. We can do this together. As many of you are aware, we are making changes to our curriculum department. We will still have one curriculum director, but we have added two curriculum specialists, one for preschool through 6th grade and one for 7 through 12. They will assume administrative duties, and their main focus will be to spend time in the classrooms, and hopefully in the literal sense, soon, assisting our teachers on instructional strategies and ensuring curriculum maps and pacing guides, as well as assessments, are being used effectively. We have invested a great deal of resources, both monetarily and in human capital, to ensure our pacing guides are utilized effectively and that the essential learning targets are addressed. We will continue that work in our middle school grades and will begin the creation of common formative assessments this year in our core subject areas. The expectation is that these guides will be adhered to and discussed and evaluated through the Ohio improvement process. Lastly, we will be redesigning our DLT process. A big thank you goes out to Diane Schenter, who has led the initiative for the last few years. Dr. Johnson will now assume the role as a facilitator while still working closely with Diane while we make this transition. Finally, I want to revisit the topic and reintroduce you to the social justice initiative that a small committee has been working on over the summer, which has been long overdue and sparked by the death of not just George Floyd, but many others who have preceded and succeeded him in death. Our committee consisted of Aaron Black, Sam Waters, Dominic Rutadaria, Cassandra Johnson, Kalisha Lewis, Kenneth Elder, and Beth Russell. We met several times to create a mission and vision statement in order to help us stay focused on the intended outcomes. Our initiative has been coined Bearcats Building Bridges to Social Justice, with an emphasis on inspiring change through courageous conversations. Our vision is to build bridges between our students, parents, and community stakeholders so that we can come together to discuss significant social justice issues in order to foster a culturally responsive environment in our schools and communities. Change cannot occur without the help of others. This is a community effort, and we will do our part as the nucleus of the four communities to unite people as we work to create a culturally responsive environment for our students as stakeholders. In order to support our social justice initiative, there are a number of activities, events, and ideas that have been created. First, we will be working with Pastor Larry Macon Jr., who will serve as a part-time diversity coordinator for the district. Pastor Larry will help us plan and coordinate various ideas around equity and diversity matters concerning staff, students, and families. He will co-facilitate our Diversity and Equity Leadership Advisory Team, which is yet to be established, and he will assist in our strategic planning goal around equity. Pastor Larry will also provide us with informative, thought-provoking articles and activities throughout the year. You will take part in the first one in the first day of school. This summer, we turned on our porch lights to unite the night to help kickstart our cause. We will be working on a mural that students will create tentatively on our high school visitors' lot. We will also hold three community forums a year and will take part in book talks for those who are interested in furthering are conversations about race. Dominic and Sam will be taking part in a lead diversity program through the Diversity Center, which will help them become better versed in helping lead the district on our path to social justice. And now to start the journey, please take a look at the video we shared with our community partners. At the conclusion of the video, we'll have a halftime show like no other, except this one will be rated G. In the current climate of global unrest, we as educators have the responsibility to lead conversations about inequality and the platform in which to lead them. As an anti-racist organization that is committed to eliminating barriers and assuring that all students have the necessary tools to ensure success, we believe that everyone deserves respect and equal treatment, and we stand together with the Black community against hate, intolerance, and racism. But making a statement is just the first small step in the path to social justice. Words alone are not enough. In an effort to create an atmosphere of open-mindedness where differences will be respected and not feared or judged, we formed a committee to help facilitate and encourage open, honest, and sometimes tough conversations among all of our stakeholders, including our students, parents, staff, community members, civic organizations, and local law enforcement agencies. What better way to begin than by determining a mission and vision? We are calling our initiative Bearcats Building Bridges to Social Justice. Our mission is inspiring change through courageous conversations.
Our vision is to build bridges
between our students, parents, and community stakeholders
so that we can come together to discuss significant social justice issues
in order to foster a culturally responsive environment
in our schools and communities.
As educators, we have a responsibility to address the social and emotional needs of children and to help create a world we hope they can live in as adults. We will continually work together and sponsor events throughout the year to encourage conversations promoting social justice and building bridges to help close the gaps and eliminate the barriers that create inequities. And to help us launch our new initiative, we invite you to join us to Unite the Night on Thursday, July 23rd at 8 o'clock by turning on your porch lights for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, which has become a symbol of George Floyd's death, as well as others who have lost their lives unjustly. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's the end of the first half. It's time for the halftime show. We have a very exciting halftime presentation for you today. We're going to play The Masked Singer. Three contestants will sing, and you, the audience, will try and guess their secret identity.
About a thing, 'cause every little thing is gonna be alright. Don't worry about a thing, 'cause every little thing is gonna be alright. Rise up this morning, smile with the rising sun. Three little birds outside my doorstep, singing sweet songs of melodies pure and true. Singing, this is my message to you. Singing, don't worry about a thing, 'cause every little thing, it's gonna be alright. Don't worry about a thing, 'cause every little thing, it's gonna be alright.
Thank you. I believe that children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside. Give them a sense of pride to make it easier. Let the children's laughter remind us how we used to be.
Coming back on the field, once again, is your superintendent, Dr. Andrea Celico.
Well, who can top that? I'm grateful for our three courageous candidates who not only had fun with the Masked Singer, but chose songs to remind us we are all in this together. How many of you out there got them all right? Okay, we can't have all fun and games, so I have to get back to work.
Before I talk about finances, I would be remiss if I didn't introduce you to our new treasurer, Bill Parkinson, who comes to us from Willoughby Eastlake School District. Welcome, Bill. We are glad to have you as part of the Bedford family.
We have excellent news to report as it relates to our financial standing. We have managed to remain solvent while adding a number of services for our students through creative means as we continue to analyze our funding sources and to use them wisely in order to alleviate the general fund. By doing so, we will not ask the voters for money until next year, which brings our levy cycle to 7 years. In 25 years of being in education, I don't recall any of my previous districts stretching a levy that long. While we have not determined if we will go for a levy in May or November of next year, we anticipate having to ask the voters to pass an operating levy in which we intend to keep the millage close to what it has been in the past. The next challenge will be determining when we go for a bond issue. Due to COVID and its effects on the economy and the funding for new schools, our time frame has shifted, and the earliest we would solicit funds for new schools would be in 2022. We recognize the challenge this presents, which is two levies back to back, but it is evident now more than ever the need for new schools. Our students and staff deserve it. We will reconvene our community planning committee this fall to continue our conversations and planning. While I've addressed new schools, I might as well address old ones as well. We are currently in the process of demolishing Chanel. We hope to be looking at a beautiful green space by the end of October. The Board of Education wisely chose to purchase and demolish the debilitated building. There is so much promise that lies ahead. We also learned just a couple short weeks ago that we had a couple of offers on the Aurora property, and we are optimistic that we will receive a great settlement for that property as well.
and now to attempt a 73-yard field goal, business manager Jerry Zgrabik.
Good morning. It's my pleasure to announce to you the 2020 Classified Staff Employee of the Year Award. This will be the 30th person to have won the award. The first award was presented in 1991, and on the screen before you, you will see the names of those recipients. The ones highlighted in yellow are still employed with the Board of Education. If you see them throughout today or in the next few days, please remind them how important it is to have received this award. What is being said about the Employee of the Year by staff members who nominated him? He is always willing to help when asked, can fix anything, and has the job done before you even know he started it. He is among the most friendly of any person working in the Bedford City Schools. He always has a smile on his face, and my day is better just having seen him in the hallways. He completes his work with a craftsman, artist-like approach. Whatever attractive modern elements Bedford High School has in its old bones, his stamp is on them. I cite the Makerspace and Kennedy Center for Gaming as evidence. In the past, a principal wrote about him that he took care of the building as if it was his own. So friendly and helpful to staff and students, went beyond to keep the schools safe and clean. Did a morning walkthrough and would fix items without being asked. His professionalism was appreciated. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the 2020 Employee of the Year, Mr. Sam Cardinal, Maintenance Custodian, Bedford High School. Sam began with the school district in September of 1993 and previously held the position of Security Custodian. From his evaluation, these words stand out: organized, dedicated, dependable, very innovative, good problem solver, flexible with assignments, and great rapport with students and parents. Congratulations, Sam.
And that is the end of the third quarter. And now, it's hot dog derby time. Good morning, race fans. Once again, it's time for the classic hot dog, ketchup, and mustard race. The stakes have never been higher. This year, if mustard wins, CTE wins. If ketchup wins, third grade at Central wins. And if the hot dog wins, middle school music is the big winner. You can see some of the contestants' zeal as they stretch and prepare to both race and entertain. You know, it's really the love of the race that drives ketchup. And it's really that competitive spirit that makes hot dog want to go the extra mile. And mustard, knowing the things that mustard had to do to get to this point, drives her to this day. And here we go. And they're off to an early start. We have mustard jumping out in the lead. We have ketchup behind and hot dog falling shortly after. Ketchup is going so fast that her hot dog hat flew off. And they're coming down the track as we get going. Looks like mustard has a steady lead. And who's coming forward here? It's going to be mustard! Mustard wins! What an amazing race! I can't believe I was there to witness that! Mustard wins! Mustard wins! Heading back on the field is your assistant superintendent, Dr. Cassandra Johnson.
Good morning, Bedford Bearcats. Welcome back to the 2020-21 school year. I'm so excited to have the opportunity to announce the Rookie of the Year and the Teacher of the Year recipients. First off, the Rookie of the Year. The previous recipients are listed, but I would like to take this time to recognize our previous recipients that are still employed in the Bedford City School District. We have Mr. Muniak, Megan Evans, Levi Crozier, Teresa Spizak, Brian Conyers, William Pullman, and Zach Toad. This year's recipient is an outstanding teacher. They have been known to be called fantastic, and if anyone walks in their classroom
on any given day, you would not even know that they are a first-year teacher. They have taken everything this year that has been thrown their way with stride and grace. They are involved in student activities outside of the classroom. They serve on building level committees. They have innovative ideas, and they are not afraid to take risk, but actively they look forward for feedback so they can improve. They're reflective of their teaching practices. They're motivated to try new things. They strive to gain something new from all of their colleagues. They have a willingness to experiment with pedagogical strategies. They have a solid rapport with students and have known to be an active contributor to the school culture. They make the content fun for their students. They are engaging their lessons through various platforms and methodologies to reach all students. And lastly, but most importantly, the enthusiasm. They are enthusiastic about teaching, and they show a tremendous amount of concern for their students' lives in order to establish a personal relationship with them. I'm so honored to announce our 2020-21 Rookie of the Year, Brenna McNamara of Heskett Middle School. Next, we have the Teacher of the Year. Once again, let's recognize our past Teachers of the Year recipients that are currently employed. Leah Potapinko, Robin Golick, Sean Smith, Mike Zolotel, Nathan Marin, Cheryl Goldstein, Brett Johnson, Julie Sanders, Andy Johnson, Pat Wilms, Elaney Marin, Crystal Brooks, Melanie Crofta, and Melanie Kieran. Once again, we continue to thank you for your dedication to our students. This year's nominees for the 2020-21 School Year Teachers of the Year, from Bedford High School, Krista Thomas, Heskett Middle School, Leah McKean, Carrollwood Intermediate, Fran Sinicki, Columbus Intermediate, Cheryl Tansky, Central Primary, Katie Lubbock, and Glendale Primary, Brandy Rigby. This year's recipient is always so professional, even during the most difficult times. They take time to build positive relationships with their colleagues, students, and parents. Their pedagogical methods are progressive and transformative in nature. They regularly attend professional development to strengthen their knowledge of how students learn best. They foster the type of community and connectiveness we strive for in Bedford City School District to improve student achievement and the climate and culture of the entire school community. They have served as a teacher leader in various roles, as well as a mentor to our new teachers. Lastly, they serve on the Building PBIS team, and they often go above and beyond the call of duty of what's expected of them in order to provide positive experiences for our students. Congratulations, Brandy Rigby, teacher at Glendale Primary. We are honored to have you, and we appreciate your dedication to our students.
We have a substitution, student speaker Anthony Merritt.
Hi, my name is Anthony Merritt Jr., a proud Bedford graduate of the class of 2020. I want to thank Dr. Celico, Mrs. Brennan, and Ms. Lewis for this opportunity to honor the village that has supported me almost my whole life. I became a bureaucrat in second grade at Central Primary School. I had the pleasure of being in Mrs. Delotti's class for second and third grade. During our silent work or reading time, we both shared a love for Michael Jackson, and she would always play either his CD or the Stevie Wonder CD too. Her classroom is where I discovered my dream to study weather, and I am so excited to fulfill that dream at Valparaiso University this fall. And due to my mom's infamous Facebook page, I'm so happy that they're still Facebook buddies because Mrs. Gelati stays in touch and keeps up with my mom's 4,000 pictures of me. I'm so grateful for her support as I go out to college. I don't know how many students can say the same about their second and third grade teacher, but mine is definitely one of a kind. Another blessing was having the strong presence of an African-American male principal, Mr. Lifford Sr. He always wore nice suits and stood in the hallway to greet us every morning. I also appreciated the warm greetings from Central Secretary Mrs. Gura and the many heart-to-heart talks with the guidance counselor, Mrs. Adamson. Looking back, I believe my art teacher, Mr. Gabriel, planted a seed for me to grow my locks when he cut all of his hair off before our third grade graduation. Central truly laid the foundation of support, and it was super hard to leave. Moving on to Columbus School, where I was part of the Blossom and Pride program, where I was placed in the all-boys classes, fourth through sixth grade. My fourth grade teacher, Mrs. Buckley, and her wonderful assistant, Mrs. Bird, had a classroom with AC, so our class was chilling during the hot months. I was so happy that Mrs. Buckley and Mrs. Gelati were also good friends. Mrs. Buckley got me hooked on the Percy Jackson book series, which is still one of my favorites. Also in fourth grade, I achieved the best academic award you can achieve at Columbus, which was the President Award for getting straight A's all four quarters. I love the fact that Bedford does the award ceremonies because the recognition motivates you to keep working hard. My fifth grade teacher, Mrs. Bozinski, changed my life when she gave me the application for REACH, which is a summer enrichment program at university school for fellow Black male students. REACH made a positive impact on my life and by helping me become a successful student. Ironically, Principal Lifford's son, Terry Lifford Jr., is the director of the REACH program. I would have never guessed that he would become the greatest mentor I could ever ask for and someone I still talk to this day. Also in fifth grade, I found my love for music by learning how to play the saxophone from my band teachers, Dr. Ober, Mrs. Popovich, and Mr. Ralph, who was a sub. Even though I had to give up recess twice a week, it was still worth it because their support made it fun. Finally, in sixth grade, I had Miss Stevens. All of my past female teachers were like having a mom right there in the school, but Miss Stevens played that role to a T. Lord knows how silly me and my classmates were every second of the day, but she was very understanding and patient with us. She had a lot of deep talks with us too, like for example, when Nelson Mandela passed that year. The whole week we did assignments covering his life achievements and what he fought for in South Africa. We even did side-by-side comparisons between the teachings of Nelson Mandela and Dr. Martin Luther King. It really started to open my eyes to the world around me, and I'm definitely grateful for those lessons. Miss Stevens and Mrs. Bird were also my line dance partners at the school dances too. Lastly, I wanted to give a shout out to one of my favorite bus drivers, Miss Susan, who took me and other students to school and back home safely every day. I also had her often as a bus driver for our away baseball games in high school too. She always asked how my family and I were doing. She truly enjoyed watching me play my favorite sport and cheered our team on every time. Onward to Heskett, which was the best years of my life because I met all of my best friends that I have now and all of my teachers that I had were amazing. I'll never forget the big sign that Mr. Milne always had right when you walked into the room that read, "Welcome to Success." Mr. Milne is still super close with me and my group of friends because we used to eat lunch in his room on Tuesdays and Thursdays. He would always crack jokes and laugh with us. He also helped us with our work, and he was someone we could talk to about middle school issues. He still is the coolest teacher now that he was back then, and I'm so grateful that he always checks up on us. I also love my eighth grade teacher, Miss Spate, who stayed on us a lot since I had all of my friends in her class. She joked around with us from time to time, but she still always made sure we did our work and that our grades were cool. I'll never forget how fun it was to do the Shakespeare play, A Midsummer Night's Dream, because I made a pretty good actor, if I say so myself. Next, I had Mr. Roberts for social studies, who kept all of us on top of our work. And if we weren't, then he would always hold up his hand phone and say, "I'm gonna call your house boss." Then I had the stricter teachers as well, like Ms. Cormack and Ms. Mella, who really scared the silliness out of me at times. But they both taught me how to balance having fun and when it was time to be serious. I also had more amazing teachers like Mr. Euler, who always challenged me in math and even on the basketball court, even though I didn't make the team. But he was a super cool teacher, and I'll never forget his love for the Buckeyes and Friday morning silent speedball. I also love having Mr. Phillips in eighth grade. He was definitely way more than a social studies teacher. He was more like a life teacher, especially for us boys. He always made sure we learned about our culture and history by showing us the movie Roots and other documentaries. I enjoyed having open discussions and debates in his class because they're really essential to me and my classmates. I also love having Mr. Michaels for health, and especially gym, since we would always try to play him in one-on-one and we would lose every time because he used his size against us, so he was cheating. At Heskett, I had one of my favorite baseball coaches ever, and that was Mr. Salone. He really brought out the best in our team, and he always made sure we stayed respectful and humble, even though we blew out the other teams by a lot. And I still do that to this day. It's always a nice laugh when I see him and he tries to act like I'm not taller than him, knowing that I definitely passed him up in eighth grade. I also love the combo of Ms. Rutowski and Mr. Brinson as our class principal and guidance counselor. My friend group and I were and still are super close to them, so we could always come to them for anything. They joked around with us at lunch all the time, too. Lastly, I definitely wanted to give a shout out to the after school hours janitors who opened up the band room for me countless times because I forgot my instrument, and for keeping the school clean because I know firsthand we made a mess, especially in the lunchroom or after the school dances. Lastly, we've made it to Bedford High. There are so many great staff, including principals, Mr. Walters, and Mr. Thompson, who I literally see everywhere outside of school now. We even both went up to Planet Fitness at the same time on the same day. From every cafeteria aide that knew how much I love my PB&J combos, to the librarian, Mrs. Sullins, who always greeted me with a warm smile whenever I came to the library or when I saw her in the hallway. I loved every single teacher that I had during all my 4 years of high school, but I definitely had a lot of standouts. One of them was Mrs. Nara, for sure. She was definitely one of the best school moms you could ever ask for. If you were having a rough day or just needed help with anything, she would always be there to help you and talk to you no matter what. Another one was Miss Keister, who was always on me for my procrastination habits in honors chem in 10th grade. I loved being in her class, especially in AP Chem my junior year. Our class was super small, so it allowed us to really have a tight bond. And because of that, it made a difficult class feel a lot easier. She also helped me with a lot of my college search junior year, so she was really there for me a lot. Next, I love having Mrs. Zerke, mainly because I had him twice every day my junior year. I used to hate that nickname, Tony, but he would do it on purpose just to mess with me. But he's the reason why I let a few people call me Tony now. Just a few. Mr. Zerke was always on me and had high expectations for me, and I'm grateful that he has always pushed me. I also loved having Mr. Cameron, not only as a teacher, but also as a baseball coach for half of my sophomore baseball season. He knew how bad I wanted to be on varsity, so he pushed me off season and regular season until I got moved up to varsity halfway through the season. I still use some of his drills that he taught me in my training today as I try to prepare for college. During my senior year, I was happy to finally be able to take his African American Studies class. I did a lot of my own research before, so I knew a lot of the things going on in his class, but I still learned a lot that I didn't know previously. The main thing that I liked was our discussion and debates that we had about certain race-related topics and I could have easily talked for hours, so he continuously shut me down so others could speak. We also had a lot of one-on-one discussions outside of class, including virtually during the COVID shutdown. Some of my greatest high school memories were made in band and band camp, thanks to my band directors, Mr. Nichols and Ms. Schoaf. I learned a lot from them, not only about music and corny jokes, but life in general. They always held me at a high standard and pushed me to become an excellent leader in all that I do. The skills they taught me will for sure last me a lifetime, and for that, I'm forever grateful. I also got to have Mrs. Dillard, who really taught me how to take my writing to the next level and really pushed me to produce quality work every assignment, and I really love that. Since I had Mrs. Dillard for English, I got to meet her next door neighbor, Mrs. Brennan. I talked to her a lot in the hallway, and somehow, some way, her and my mom are now Facebook buddies. But she really wanted to see a lot out of me and pushed me to do things like the Rotary Club meetings in January and even this speech right now. Without her push, I definitely wouldn't be standing or on video before you. So I thank Mrs. Brennan and Mrs. Dillard for really pushing me to become more active in the community and making me a better person and more confident person. Lastly, I had the honor to have Mr. Brown twice out of my 4 years of high school, and it was truly something special. I believe one of the best things he does as a teacher is learn about all his students either before or within the first week of school, so he knows everyone's strengths and weaknesses. Because of that, it was super quick for him and I to get cool with each other. He pushed me the whole year with wanting me to exceed expectations and produce quality work. His push made me ace all four quarters and a midterm, so I was one of the only ones who was exempt from his long final exam, thankfully. After that, I think literally one of the only things he would talk to me about besides baseball was AP Calc. Honestly, he wanted me to take AP Calc so bad, I don't think he would have let me graduate without taking it. But I'm glad I did, because it was definitely a tough challenge, but that's what made it fun. And having Mr. Brown as a teacher definitely made it better. In conclusion, the biggest disappointment that the pandemic took from me was the cancellation of baseball and not being able to play my senior year. Coach Crozier really loved our senior corps, and he was just as hurt as we were, but our bond with our coach would never be broken. COVID may have stolen senior events such as prom and traditional graduation, but it didn't stop the support of every staff and teacher making sure that we graduated. The drive-in graduation ceremony was truly an amazing alternative, and the fireworks show was unforgettable. Mrs. Brennan and everyone who helped her did an amazing job celebrating every way they could, and for that, I'm truly grateful to have graduated from a school district filled with this much love and respect for our students. Hopefully things will be back to normal soon, especially for the class of 2021. But always remember, students, you have a staff that will always be there for you no matter what, just like I did. Thank you for allowing me to speak. I hope everyone stays healthy and blessings on the new school year ahead. Thank you.
Out to attempt the onside kick is your superintendent, Dr. Andrea Celico.
Though we are all saddened by the inability to come together, I am hopeful that this video, at least in part, helped you smile and reminded you of why we are all here. Team, let's do the best we can to continue to provide a quality education, like the one Anthony spoke of, to all of our students, and let's help our families who depend on us. As always, I am proud to be your superintendent and appreciate all you do for our community. Best of luck as we start our new school year. Thank you.
Best of luck, everyone, for this upcoming year. Shout out to all of those who helped with COVID in the spring. Be safe. Stay strong. We're all in this together.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry. Be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry.
Be happy. Don't worry. Be happy now. Don't worry. Be happy. Don't worry. Be happy. Got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry. Be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry. Be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry. Be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy.
Don't worry. Be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile, but don't worry.